welcome everybody, and I would like to present my talk on Genistein-mediated autophagy stimulation as an approach for treatment of genetic and neurodegenerative diseases. Neurodegenerative diseases are the big problem with medicine, and actually they are the fourth cause of the death of people in the world. And unfortunately, it is expected that the number of people suffering from neurodegenerative diseases will increase rapidly. And I will focus on our work, which is focused on the genetic diseases with neurodegenerative components. And we started with mucopolysaccharidosis. This is a group of lysosomal storage diseases in which glycosaminoglycans are stored. And they are complex sugars, and if they cannot be degraded, there are different symptoms, including growth deficit, dysfunctions of visceral organs, bone and joint disorder, and functional disorders of central neuron system and so sensory organs. Those diseases appear from the defects in the enzymes which degrade glycosaminoglycans. Since degradation is the process sequential, it means one enzyme can work only after the previous one cut off monosugar or chemical moiety from glycosaminoglycans. Thus, if any of those enzymes is deficient, the products cannot be degraded and the glycosaminoglycans accumulate in cells. So we can see the huge accumulation in lysosomes. Well, there is a problem because it caused the very severe disease, including neurons and brain. So there is an enzyme replacement therapy, which has been introduced in a few of types of mucopolysaccharidosis. However, we cannot treat the neurodegenerative processes in those diseases. Thus, we're working on to develop the substrate reduction therapy. What's this? In normal cells, the synthesis and degradation of glycosaminoglycans are in balance. However, if the degradation is impaired due to mutation, then the glycosaminoglycans accumulate in cells. So the idea was to slow down the synthesis so we can get back the balance. Well, it was easy to write, but difficult to manage. However, we found the one product, genistein, which is natural isoflavones found in several natural compounds. The soybean is rich in this compound. And it was known that genistein has several biological activities. However, we found that inhibition of glycosaminoglycans occurs if genistein is added to the culture of cells derived from patients suffering from mucopolysaccharidosis. And also, we could observe the clearance of the storage material after addition of genistein to the cell culture. Working on the mechanism, we found that the synthesis of glycosaminoglycans must be stimulated by epidermal growth factor, and then the cascade of the kinase reactions. So finally, specific transcription factors can enter the nuclei, and then the transcription occurs of genes coding for enzymes involved in glycosaminoglycan synthesis. So if degradation is impaired due to a genetic defect of the enzymes, which are responsible for degradation, then accumulation of glycosaminoglycans occurs. So if genistein can stop the signal transduction leading to transcription activation of genes coding for glycosaminoglycan synthesis, then there is no such a regulation. So the transport of the transcription factor is blocked, and then the transcription cannot occur. So genistein acts as an inhibitor of epidermal growth factor receptor. And then we could observe the clearance of the storage material and if any residual activity of the deficient enzyme is present. Well, so we tested if this works also in the animal model. So we used the animal model of mucopolysaccharide resistant type 3B, and we found that genistein provided orally reduced the accumulation of glycosaminoglycans significantly. And what is more, we performed several behavioral tests, and we found that there is possibility to correct behavior of the affected animals using oral administration of genistein for several months. So after this period, the sick animals treated with genistein could not be distinguished behaviorally from healthy animals. Okay, so we found that genistein, which can cross the blood-brain barrier, can be used to correct symptoms, neurological symptoms, in mucopolysaccharidosis. However, unexpectedly, we also found that there is another mechanism, not only substrate reduction, but genistein is also an inhibitor of mTOR kinase. And then dephosphorylation of transcription factor EB occurs, and the transcription factor EB can enter the nucleus, and the transcription factor EB is the master regulator of lysosomal biogenesis. So the lysosomal proteins are synthesized, and the activity of lysosomes is stimulated. So the GAC degradation can also be stimulated if there is any residual activity of the enzyme. So we have double mechanism of action of genistein in mucopolysaccharidosis. Nevertheless, knowing that genistein can stimulate biogenesis of lysosomes, we ask if genistein can be used for treatments of also other neurodegenerative diseases, which are caused by storage of any compounds. So maybe it was possible to propose that this is a new approach of treatment in various neurodegenerative diseases. So we use another disease, Huntington's disease, as a model to test this hypothesis. And Huntington's disease is caused by a mutation in the HTT gene located on the sixth chromosome, or the fourth chromosome, sorry. And the mutation consists of extension of the CG repeat, which codes for glutamine. So in healthy people, the stretch of glutamines is below 26 residues. However, if there are more than 40 glutamine residues, then in the affected protein, the mutant Huntington, such a protein cannot fold properly, and we observe the aggregates of the mutant Huntington. And this leads to impaired function of neurons, neurodegeneration, and specific symptoms of Huntington's disease, like chorea, low muscular strength, decreased memory, and personal changes. So there are many attempts to treat Huntington's disease, like inhibition of gene expression, binding of the inactivation of the protein, increased viability of neurons. However, none of them gave satisfactory results. So we ask if stimulation of degradation of improperly folded proteins can be a good approach for treatment of such a disease. And I would like to remind you that there are two major pathways of protein degradation in eukaryotic cells. One of them is proteasomal degradation, when the ubiquitinated proteins can be degraded in the proteasome. However, this pathway in Huntington's disease is inhibited because improperly folded Huntington, the product of the HTT gene, blocks the proteasomal functions. So another way for protein degradation is autophagy. Autophagy is a specific process in which autophagosome is formed from the membranes, intercellular membranes, which engulf the unfolded proteins or damaged organelles or other unnecessary substrate. And then autophagosome fuse with lysosomes, and the degradation of various compounds can occur. So this is autophagy. And since we knew that genistein inhibits mTOR, which leads to activation of transcription factor EB, and then there is a stimulation of lysosomal biogenesis. And since lysosomes are necessary for autophagy, so then we ask if such a process may be a new approach for treatment of Huntington disease. So we use the cellular model of Huntington disease in which we overexpressed the mutant Huntington exon 1, which includes this long stretch of codons coding for glutamine. So we found that if we add genistein to the cell cultures expressing mutant Huntington, then we observe the significant decrease in the level of aggregates, of aggregated Huntington. Actually, the soluble form of mutant Huntington also decreased. We ask if we can resolve the problem of formation of aggregates. And indeed, you can see that the aggregates disappear. Mutant Huntington aggregate disappear after treatment with genistein. And we observe the decrease in the number of aggregates and also decrease of the size of aggregates. So it means that this process occurs efficiently in those cells. Interestingly, genistein did not affect levels of normal Huntington. So it is safe. And this is hypothesis that it works because of activation of autophagy, which leads to degradation only of mutant Huntington because it forms aggregates. The cells expressing mutant Huntington have low variability because they are very sick. However, if we add genistein to the cell cultures, we observe the increase in viability of the cells, which is as in normal cells. Well, so we ask if genistein induced autophagy indeed in this model, and this is the case. So we observe the increase in the LC3-2 protein, which is a marker of the autophagy process. And this was very efficient. So we ask if genistein increased the number of lysosomes, as it should, if the hypothesis is true, and this is the case. So genistein increased the autophagy because of the stimulation of lysosomal biogenesis. So we observe stimulation of lysosomes and degradation of mutant Huntington. So the question is if there are two processes which are independent, or the stimulation of autophagy by genistein leads to degradation of the mutant Huntington. So we inhibited the autophagy stimulation process by genistein using the inhibitor of autophagy, which is chloroquine. The chloroquine causes the inhibition of the autophagy flux. So we observe this efficient inhibition of autophagy. And then we observe that degradation of mutant Huntington was impaired if the autophagy was blocked. So it means that stimulation of autophagy by genistein leads to efficient clearance of the mutant Huntington in the cellular model of this disease. So we ask if this lead is effective. So maybe we can treat other neurodegenerative disease using genistein. And we use the rat model of sporadic Alzheimer's disease. Oh, as you know, the Alzheimer's disease is a big problem in medicine. And there are two forms of Alzheimer's disease. The familiar form, which is caused by specific mutations, but it's only 10 to 15% of patients have this form. The sporadic form of Alzheimer's disease is much more frequent. And what causes Alzheimer's disease? Or the accumulation of two proteins, the beta amyloid and hypophosphorylated tau protein, which is called p-tau. So then this leads to cascade of the processes, which ends with death on the neurons and neurodegeneration. And the symptoms of Alzheimer's disease is memory disease, uncredited speech, other symptoms you already know. So beta amyloid and p-tau aggregates are the major problem in this disease. So again, many attempts was proposed to treat Alzheimer's disease, how inhibition of secretases, binding of and activation of beta amyloid by antibodies, inhibition of kinases. However, again, none of them works well. So we ask if stimulation of degradation of protein aggregates can be proposed as a treatment approach for this disease. So we use a streptozotocin-induced rat model of sporadic Alzheimer's disease. So we treated rats by streptozotocin, which is a toxin produced by streptomyces griseus, the microorganism. And this leads to the symptoms resembling exactly the Alzheimer's disease, including beta amyloid plaques formation and accumulation of hypophosphorylated tau protein. So we treat those rats, and then we either use the placebo and the water, and the genistein administered orally. And we perform several behavioral tests. The major one was Morris water mice test, in which we have a pool, and then we put the animal into the pool, and there is a platform which the rat can escape from the pool. So the rat is looking for the platform. And the platform is under the water. So in the pretest, so the rats are looking for the escape and they find they randomly. However, after several days, they learn where the platform is, so they can find it very quickly. And however, if the rats cannot learn, so then they cannot find the platform. Okay, so we can measure the time of finding the platform, the distance traveled to the platform, and the time spent in the quadrant with the platform, and the number of entrants to the quadrant of the platform. So we can measure those parameters. And I would like to show the experiment in which used the Alzheimer rats with and without treatment. And you can see that the lower panel indicates how quick the rat can find the platform after genistein treatment and several days of training. However, in the same condition, but without genistein, the Alzheimer rat cannot learn. So the every day, the animal is looking for the escape randomly. So we can see at the lower panel that the rat has already found the platform very quickly. However, at the upper panel, untreated rat was looking for the platform just random. And we found that every parameter has improved significantly after treatment with genistein. So actually, the animals could not be distinguished from healthy animals after treatment with genistein. And there are several parameters which indicated this is really the case. And also the time spent by the rats in the quadrant with the platform was present is the same in Alzheimer's rats treated with genistein as in the control, the healthy animals. However, the streptozotocin treated rats and not treated with genistein were very poor in this test. Another test was a novelty test in which we investigate the movements. And you can see again that the untreated Alzheimer rats were very different from the healthy animals. However, when genistein was applied, the Alzheimer disease disappeared actually because the animals were undistinguishable from the healthy animals. So we asked if we can also observe the biochemical improvement in brains of the rats, and indeed we observed the genistein reduced the levels of beta amyloid. It was by immunohistochemistry, and also biochemically we could demonstrate that genistein normalized the levels of beta amyloid. And also this was the case in the for the most pathogenic forms of beta amyloid, forms 40 and 42. And the same in p-tau. Hypophosphorylated p-tau proteins was also decreased and actually normalized after treatment with genistein of the Alzheimer rats. And also we could demonstrate this biochemically. The question was if genistein stimulates autophagy also in the Alzheimer's disease model. And this was the case, as we could demonstrate that genistein efficiently stimulates autophagy, measured as increase in the LCF3-2 marker protein in brains of the animals. So genistein efficiently induced autophagy also in the brains, and also TFEB level was increased in the presence of genistein. So we again asked, using the cellular model in which we overproduced the precursor of the beta amyloid, and genistein efficiently reduced the level of this protein. However, if the autophagy was inhibited by chloroquine, genistein could not improve the levels of this protein again. So we can conclude the stimulation of autophagy is efficient also in Alzheimer's disease. So stimulation of autophagy by genistein can be considered as a potential common therapy for various neurodegenerative diseases caused by accumulation of toxic macromolecules. And we could demonstrate this for three different diseases: mucopolysaccharidosis, Huntington's disease, and Alzheimer's disease. And I would like to thank the team working on this subject. Thank you very much, my friends, for collaboration. And I will be happy to answer any questions. And if you would like to contact me for discussion, collaboration, here are my contact details. Thank you very much for your attention.